Fantastic. Good evening, everybody, if I could have a little bit of your attention now that I've blown your ears out. I'd like to kick off a little conference that we are doing here to talk about the evolution of naval architecture, the future of ocean racing, and indeed how foils play a big, big part in that evolution. Notably, one of the big manufacturers that are building not only the boats that sustain these incredible speeds, but also the foils that allows them to achieve them, are indeed Persico. And so first up, if I could have a little introduction here from Mr. Persico himself. His name is on the boatyard and it's on a shirt.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's so nice to be back here. And I feel it's very emotional to be back. I call in the family, yeah, because I feel part of the family of the Ocean Race. And seeing that it's happening again with a lot of friends, a lot of familiar faces, and again, the boat we built most of the boat on the dock are coming from our yard, so I feel proud personally, and I think all the team. So it's really nice, really nice. From our side, from Persico, we never really stop. Luckily, we were working in the America's Cup environment with Luna Rossa and doing some projects, some custom projects. So we always push on technology process, which I really have to hand over to those guys to talk about. I'm not, expert enough to be sitting, so I leave the right people to talk about that. Thank you very much.
Thank you indeed. Now, in terms of the evolution of foiling, in many ways it started off with the small boats. The Moth were the first boats to really take flight and start sailing down this new generation. And then in 2012 with the AC72, it was Team New Zealand that blew everybody's socks off and showed that it's not just little boats, it's big boats that can fly as well. And with big boats comes big teams, big speeds, and new engineering challenges. From there, it has been the Mocha class that first in 2015 equipped the boats with wings so that they could really start to fly. And then from then on, we've seen a trickle-down evolution of more and more classes adopting foils, both from Swans now in One Design Racing to indeed another project from Persico, the 69F, which is further proving that this new foiling flying technology is becoming more and more democratic throughout sailing. So Mark Somerville, maybe you can give us a little bit of a heads up about how this evolution has been running through Persico and how the yard has seen this evolution.
Yeah, thanks, mate. Yep. Always good to have another Kiwi up here to support me as well.
Thank you. He is the most Italian of all Kiwis in the world, I think.
Probably. Yeah, it started quite a long time ago for us. The evolution for us was around 2011, 2012, where we were lucky enough to support Luna Rossa with the AC72 big catamaran. And so we started developing with them the engineering design and the manufacturing skills, and we started with the SL33 program, which is obviously a much smaller boat, and then we used that to evolve up to the AC72s during that period. And basically from then on, we evolved from then into the AC50s and then on to the AC75s. And in the middle of that, for us over those years, we've been working quite extensively with the Mocha class, as we see the boats out here today. And so that evolution for me is still going. Those started quite small, and as we've seen, even from the AC72s to 75s to even the AC50s, they're really, really, really long foils. And obviously these, you know, become very difficult to manufacture and to engineer. And then in recent times, we've been building the foils for the Swan, Club Swan 36. And of course the Persico 69F, which most people are quite delighted to see on the screen today. So I think last night I was counting, and I think we're over 90 foils that we're responsible for, yep, on boats today on the water. So I think this year we will probably hit the big number 100.
Yep. Now crucially, a lot of the classes that you made reference to there are at the very pointy end of yacht racing, both from big boats to small boats. They all go fast. how does this new development of foils relate to the rest of sailing? You know, it's not everybody that's going to put wings and fly around. So how does that relate to perhaps the more leisure-oriented or the more sort of everyday style of sailing?
Yeah, interesting question. I think just like the smaller boats, like everyone's liked the evolution of small boats, even in the Moths, you know, it's going a lot, the boats are going faster. If we went back to when the Moths started foiling until today, you know, they're foiling upwind of over 20 knots. So most people, if I'm right, enjoy, you know, whether it's a car or a boat or anything else, they enjoy speed and excitement. And you can see that with the youths today. The youths are now wanting more Wasps and, you know, more exciting boats, not like maybe the Optimist. Yep. They're all looking to where they can go. So the evolvement of foils today, I think it's the same with the older people, like you and I. We enjoy going fast. Yep. We enjoy the speed, the excitement. And we are working today on projects which are not high-end. They're not the America's Cup, not the Ocean Race. They're not the high-end brunt of it. But the technology of that's definitely trickling down into projects which we're seeing and we're working on, which we'll see very shortly in the next 1 to 2 years. We'll see some pretty spectacular, let's say, performance cruising boats with nice foils on them.
Yep. Yep. Now back to racing. Chris Nicholson, you're the skipper of Team ExxonMobil, and if I counted correctly, you've done 6 participations in the Volvo Ocean race. Now, the history of that obviously goes back to 1973, and early on, this event had multi-classes of indeed some of the predecessors to the Swans that you're building for now. And it sort of started off with lots of different classes all competing together. And then since you joined the class and joined the race, it has only been various classes. First the 60s, the 70s, and now the 65s. What is it like to be back in a multi-class era and sort of sharing a start line with boats that are dramatically different from yours?
Well, what we currently have now with the One Design, you know, we have great close racing, and you can see that by the results we've had in the Europe Ocean Race. So, but when you put that aside and go back to where we've been in the past, where you can develop, where you can work with designers and sailors, and push boundaries in terms of engineering and like what we're talking about here with foils, it's a really exciting part of the sport. It's you know, currently what we don't have is the possibility of making that at the moment one design and foils at the moment, but potentially that could be something for the future. But it's as Mark said, for me the real exciting part of foiling is when it becomes more mainstream and when cruising boats in the future can use this technology.
And having raced now the 3 legs of the European Tour of the Ocean Race, very different performance levels that we saw at times. Can you, as a skipper, can you sort of talk to us and for those watching at home about what it was like having such different boats on the same race course? Were they adding value to you in the sense that you could see the 60s were sort of high-tailing it off in some direction? You could see that there was either pressure or no pressure over there. Like, was that adding value to you as a racer on the water?
Not so much, but what was apparent was, you know, I thought we knew there was big differences between the 65 and the Amoka, but when you get to see an Amoka light up on a reach at what it's designed for, it really, really lights up. But, you know, so we've seen, you know, there's just huge differences, but we also saw just how well designed the Mocha is for the Vonde, but obviously this style of racing that we've done is more difficult.
Yeah, and so as the Mocha 60s now line up against the One Design boats in the Ocean Race, as somebody who has spent months, if not years, in the Southern Ocean, would you like to be? Excuse me, technical difficulties on land as well. Which, if you had the open season, like and the free choice, which boat would you like to go into the Southern Ocean in next year?
Might have been.
Yep.
Were you there? Were you there?
Yep.
Wow, which would I want to go into the Southern Ocean with? I actually think just at the moment, you know, I haven't done enough time in an Amoka boat to give a valid answer, but right at the moment I'd take the 65. Mm. It's a pretty close call.
Thank you. That's awkward.
Pisco boat, right? Pisco boat.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's what we own.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's slightly awkward, but moving on. Thank you very much, Chris. Marcus Hutchinson, who is indeed the head honcho of the LinkedIn team. You are a team manager of a very high-performance Amoka 60 team. You also run a small fleet of foiling One Design, not 65s, but the Figaro 3s. And I was wondering if you can tell us a little bit about what it's like with your team manager hat on, when the rubber meets the road, when you have to convince sponsors and the public about the value of foils and what that adds to racing from your perspective.
Well, I'm very fortunate to... is that working? Yeah.
Yep.
Very fortunate to have been around a while. I need to correct you just on one point about the origins of foiling in the offshore world. There were a lot of French multi-hulls sailing around with different levels of foils back in the 80s and 90s. You know, like many things the French do, they kind of hide it and don't really let anybody outside know what it is. Suddenly we found ourselves with a global event, even though it starts and finishes in France, which is the Vendée Globe, which you've competed in with distinction, young Conrad. We're very lucky to have that race and to have a demand for that kind of boat and that kind of racing in France. The Imoca is basically an open design. There's obviously length limitations. And the idea is to make every new boat that's built faster than what was there before or more adaptable to a certain kind of sailing, as Chris rightly points out, for very much for one kind of race. So they're very type-formed in many ways, but for reaching around and what have you. We found during the last Vendée Globe that we're not very good at VMG sailing, and so there's an awful lot of work still to be done there. But when you light these things up, they are pretty impressive on the speed sides. From a team point of view, our deal at a top-end team is to go faster and to be better, and we do that by attracting the best sailors, the best designers, and the sponsors that are attracted to our kind of high-end stuff want more tech. Our own sponsor is Advance in cybersecurity. They love the tech side of it. These boats are becoming more and more digitized. There's an awful lot of data flying off. There's been data with these for a while, but now it's just overwhelming. We're moving into an altogether different era of sailing, and right now it's very overwhelming for small Imoca teams, because we are small. We're not America's Cup teams. We're not what we'd call traditional Volvo 60 teams, and we need to grow into getting the most out of our boats and this great new technology that is very exciting, but we're really just at the beginning of it. A race like we've just done, the Round Europe race, the Ocean Race Europe, where on our particular boat, Linked Out, also built by Persico, which was the original Volvo Super 60, by the way, we've benefited massively from being able to sail with enough people on board the boat to make sail changes quickly. We came to do this race because we wanted to line up with other teams. We wanted to line up against other boats. We wanted a sporting and technical challenge to understand how far behind the eight ball we really are with these boats, because it's brand new still, and we have so much to learn. And we have learned a huge amount just by lining up against all these other boats, because they're all very different. So from a team point of view, at our end, you know, our sponsors drive us to, and our team drives us to make the best and to have more and to be faster and to learn and to be efficient. But the foils have definitely added a new perspective to everything that we're doing. We're about to be on our third set of foils with this boat. And every time you put a new set of foils in, it's tragic in that within a few days of sailing, you realize that the next set is going to be even better. Not just from a data point of view, but just the characteristics of how the boat sails. And they are expensive components. They're a lot more expensive than a suit of sails. And there's also a huge time lag in making them. You know, they from deciding what you want to do to having them delivered and fitted to the boats, around 6 months in reality. So it's slow progress. And obviously, it's limited by the costs and the capacity of the industry. Luckily, we have companies like Persico and others that are able to, that are gearing up to be able to make more components more regularly. But it's still there's still a lot of inertia associated with it, and it's also pretty complex to try and work out how to make the right compromises, because as I pointed out at the beginning, our boat is designed for round the world sailing and shorthanded sailing, and is totally not so suited to what we've just done here. There have been a few points of sail and a few legs where it's been really interesting to line up with our friends at 11th Hour with a similar boat and a similar foil package, and the same with Bureau Valley, which is not a similar foil package, a similar boat, but it's been, this race has given us the opportunity to really see where we're at, and we've also learnt a lot about sailing and not much wind, which we'll leave that to another thing. So I don't know if I've answered the question, but there you go.
You certainly did. And with your team manager hat, you mentioned cost. Cost is an inevitable part of our mechanical sport. But there have been some concerns about cost runaways with the technological development and the fact that you need to buy, as you said, foils as well as sails now. But can you talk briefly about how that adds value to the team as well, and another sort of string to your bow when it comes to talking to sponsors and telling that tech story?
Yeah, well, I think if you enter the Amoca circuit, you're there for performance. You're there to see something pretty special. There's definitely a single-handed performance side, but hopefully more and more there'll be a fully crewed. We have a two-handed performance side. The class allows technological development, and I think everybody here would agree that one design is fantastic, but it's another side of sailing, and makes great sailors, but it just is about the sailors. It's not about the boat. Sure, you learn how to sail a boat better than someone else, but ultimately everyone's got the same equipment. Mm-hmm. Here we don't have the same equipment, and so when you choose which section of this massive sport of ours that you want to get involved with, you need to have the full picture behind you as to what is I'm trying to do. Do I want to go and do a one design race in Volvo 65s, or do I want to develop something? Is my partnership with my sponsors all about tech, all about developing stuff? And if it is, are there synergies that I can do that? In our case, we're extremely fortunate. That is absolutely what our campaign is about, and our partners are about. And you know, the tech sector is becoming more and more important generally, and I think see an awful lot more sponsors of the tech industry coming towards this. We don't do enough to explain a lot of all of this, but there's many miles to go, and for sure, there's cost to everything, but if the value is there, which clearly it is, otherwise we wouldn't be building as many new boats as we are right now, on we go.
Well, thank you, Marcus. There we go. For those of you watching at home and are interested in launching the campaign, come and... What's your phone number, Marcus?
I've got far too much on my plate.
Pearls, words of wisdom from young Marcus there. So, Simon Fisher, you are the navigator of Team 11th Hour Racing. You have also navigated Volvo 70s and Volvo 60s, 65s around the world. And I was wondering if you can give us a little course from the nav desk with a little compare and contrast about all of these different kinds of classes now that you're looking at settling up into a 60 around the world.
Yeah, it's actually interesting to be back in a development class again. And my first adventure into the ocean race was with the Volvo 70s when the 70s were brand new and quite exciting. It was a little bit wild. There was lots going on with the boats. Yeah. Lots of breakages, but we're learning very fast. It was pretty exciting. And you know, that obviously, when you sailed those boats, you had to make sure you weren't putting yourself in a position where you were going to break the boat. So there was a time where you said, look, we've got to slow down now. Yep. It's you've got to look after the boat. You've got to get the boat to the finish if you want to win the leg or finish well. Had varying degrees of success with that, depending on which boats I've been sailing. But and then it was interesting. Then we moved into the One Design era, yep, where... I mean, the nice thing about One Design is you're jumping on a boat that you knew was capable of winning the race. You weren't dominated by the design choices you maybe made many months before. So, and I probably had my most success in the One Design era, which was great. Mm-hmm. But it's really exciting to be back in a development class and doing that learning and being on the cutting edge. It's really fascinating and exciting, and yeah, it's really nice. But it's interesting, I think, you know, from a navigation point of view, I think with these boats, we were sort of talking a little bit about which you'd rather go in the Southern Ocean. It's a good question. I think maybe the nice thing is with the 60s, we can go a bit faster on the foil, so maybe we can route our way around the worst of the weather, whereas certainly in the last race in the 65s, so you were looking at the routing, it's like, well, do we really have to go into the middle of that thing? It's like, well, everyone else is, so off we go, you know, into 50 knots of wind. Yep. I think probably with the 60s, it's not such a... It's not going to be the right way to sail. Like obviously with the foils, we're much more dictated by C-State makes a massive part of the performance. So, I mean, we've still got a lot to learn in that area, and you know, as a team, we've got to do a lot of work into how we best learn and route and work with the tools that we have to find the fastest way through managing sea state and conditions to get the best performance in the boat. But it's going to be a fascinating challenge, certainly. I mean, we saw in this race in the first leg, 25 knots in flat water, we can average almost 30 knots of boat speed, which is incredible. I mean, we're sitting on board, big grins on our faces, you know, trying to go downwind in 25 knots in a big sea state is a pretty different story and gets pretty uncomfortable. So it's a fascinating challenge.
Now, your role as the navigator, so a chief head scratcher, has evolved significantly. We're here talking about foils and the way that naval architecture and engineering has evolved, and it's gone from sort of wood to aluminium to carbon to fiberglass and carbon fiber, and everything. Well, given the fact that it's an Olympic year, it seems appropriate to say that we're all in the pursuit of going what is it, faster, higher, stronger. That's certainly appropriate when it comes to foiling. But in the same way, the role of a navigator has evolved significantly as well, that we've gone from sextants and paper charts to now figuring out not where you are, but where you need to be. And then critically, as Marcus alluded to, these boats are generating a lot of data as well. Can you talk to us about the load cells, about the fiber optics, and the evolving role of the navigator on board?
It's true to say we got increasing amounts of technology. Obviously, you mentioned there's a lot of load monitoring, a lot of load cells on board, a lot of fiber optics in the foil, in the rig. Some boats run them in the hull as well. So you got a lot of data. There's, I don't know how many alarms on this boat. There's one design elements to the Imoca 60, like the rig, which obviously that was created before we got into the foiling technology. And now we're foiling, we can generate a tremendous amount of writing moment. And with such freedom in the rule to create different foils, there's really no limit to how much writing moment you can create, other than if you push too hard, you are going to break something. So we're putting more and more technology on the boats just to always understand where we are, you know, how hard we're pushing, understand when we can afford to push a bit harder, when we've got to be a little bit more sensible. But there is a lot of alarms on our boat, and sometimes you wish you were sort of, you'll wonder if it'd be better to be blissfully ignorant when you start accelerating and everything's like flashing and beeping at you. And it can be kind of hard as a navigator, go, look, slow down, you're going to break something. You know, it's against some people's better nature to take your foot off the gas. But I think an important bit about sailing these boats to a high degree of success is going to be managing all that information and the alarms and the technology and looking after your boat. But it's for someone who's quite into technology, it's fascinating to be involved in this class. And it's not only load monitoring and performance, but you know, cameras, vision, all of this sort of stuff we're working really hard on.
And yet all of that comes together in the role of the navigator, but the primary objective of navigator is to point the boat in the right direction. And so how does the new foiling generation offshore relate in terms of routing choices? And for people sort of watching at home and looking at the virtual tracker and trying to imagine how they would play along, can you sort of give them tips on what offshore foiling routing looks like now and some of the challenges involved in that?
Yeah, I mean, I think we've seen in this race we've just done now, there's some conditions that suits the foiling boats and others that really don't. I think actually, you know, just the results of this race creates quite an interesting challenge for the designers. And then as sailors and navigators, obviously, we've got to learn more and more about when we can use our foils to, you know, effectively and really, you know, harness the boat speed that's available with them. And that is when we're better off throttling back, maybe pulling the foils in. I'm sure the guys in the Vendée Globe learn a lot about when they can push and when they can't, when they've just got to hang in there so they can like unleash the speed when they get, you know, back into better conditions. So, but I think the interesting thing from the weather and the routing choices is going to be not only like managing the wind speed, because you get to a certain amount of wind where you're just not going to go any faster. You can sail at 25, 30 knots of wind in not much wind, so we don't need to go hunting for like, you know, 30 knots of breeze. But also the sea state's going to be important. So trying to manage your routing that you're in a nice sea state and you know, have the sea state where you can push the boat is going to be very important as well. So it's going to be interesting to see how it plays out.
Lots of tools to play with. So David Tagliapietra, you are a designer from the Luna Rossa Prada Pirelli team. We were witness to an incredible spectacle this spring in New Zealand, watching boats not just foil assisted like the Mocha 60s, but truly flying and doing dry laps. Can you talk to us about the evolution of foils in the America's Cup in the last three generations, both from as we made mention already, the AC72 with the first foiling America's Cup class into the 50s and then into the 75s, and whether you reckon that these offshore sailors should be doing what you're doing?
Yeah. Is it working? Yes, it was a dramatic evolution during these years because from 2012, the flight of Team New Zealand, there has been a huge development, especially for efficiency of those foils. If we imagine that all the displacement of the boat is concentrating on these little wings, at the beginning they were very small and pretty thick. And if we see nowadays the IMOCA or the America's Cup foils, we can see a huge development. So it was a dramatic engineering development to solve a lot of issues, structural issues, other than also fluid dynamic phenomenon that we didn't know almost at all before flying. So we are talking about cavitation due to the speed, the ventilation. So through the cycles, we went through all these problems and trying to solve it as engineers. And America's Cup cycle leave you the time to face these issues and try to solve it. So at the beginning, okay, the first cycle in 2013 allowed from no flight to fly downwind, and finally at the end flying upwind, still not so efficiently, let's say. In the second generation of the cut foiling, we have seen a huge improvement of the aspect ratio of those foils, so getting slim more and more efficient. And also the control improved a lot, and they were going upwind and downwind from the day one. So if we speak on this latest evolution of the AC72, we can see that they are, in this cup cycle, they are unstable, and through the control surfaces, crew is able to keep the boat stable and fly with the full flight always. So that is a big step ahead. And also we can consider that is a monohull flying and big control and doing match racing. And all this is reflected in the development of the foils. If we consider that nowadays we can basically, if we want, foil upwind with for a period less than 30 degree through wind angle, that means that we have a really very efficient tool under the water. So this is a little bit of an historical development through the three cycle. How that can be applied to offshore racing, let's say it's like playing with the bicycle in the garden before going cross country. And it's a little bit like that, I feel. Let's say this is what we can do eventually. The controller is able to stabilize the boat up to 1.5 meter wave. What's happened when you go to the ocean? This is a big question mark.
Well, you have 8 meters well. So yeah.
Yeah. I think if you put everything together in the future, and also the rule, obviously every boat, class boat, is producing a rule for foils. If the class rule will allow the control, electronic control, and also the sailors, and the mentality will allow that, eventually I think in the future that will be possible, because electronic will help to make it easier and safer. We can see that a little bit now with the Ultimate, no? The 30 meter trimaran. Some of them, they are trying to make a stabilized foil in a very, very fast configuration. If they will be able to do that in the ocean, that is a good mark for also other classes.
I love your perspective of the bicycle in the garden versus cross country, and you're right to point out that they're very, very different worlds. In one case, you're trying to go upwind, and frankly, those true wind angles just boggle my mind. Upwind and downwind as efficiently as possible, fully flying, and as we saw, Mochas at the moment really don't like going upwind, and certainly not in 5 knots. How different, in fact, are these worlds when it comes as from a designer's perspective? Are you using the same tools, the same approaches, obviously the same carbon? Mark would like to say the same manufacturer. How close are these very different worlds in reality?
Yeah, I think they are closer than what we think. The people involved usually are the same, the producer, the engineers. Some of them has already had the possibility to do America's Cup and offshore racing. Myself, in this case, only America's Cup. Mm-hmm. But I think the tools are very similar. You have to tune them to reach the target of what you are designing. So basically the class rule. So you have to be rule compliant and you are designing around the race course, the boat you are. So your target is different and the tool can be very, very similar, mm-hmm. let's say.
And so one of the things that I enjoyed was a big discussion during the last America's Cup about whether this was trickle up or trickle down. That lots of the America's Cup boats were taking inspiration, it seems, from the Moth. And then there were lots of smaller boat sailors, like with the Persico 69F, taking inspiration both from the boats and the ways that the America's Cup boats were sailed. How else do you see this being applied in a more wider arena in sailing? You know, Marcus was right to say that we have an incredible diversity of ways and places and that we can go sailing and enjoy the sport. And so how are these very specialized tools going to be applied in a more wider manner?
I think the spreading of the foiling will be very wide. Like we said, from the beginning, from the small to the big, back to the small, to the everyday sailing. So I see an application more and more. Obviously, there are some problem about the safety, about the reliability of the foil itself and the control, etc. But all this can be solved, and I think will be a part of the sailing of the next years for sure. Like we were saying before, our kids want to go in that way, and there's no way to stop them. So and also ourselves eventually to go cruising. Why not in a cruising foiling cut, because it's faster from one side to the other of the bay or the Gulf, and this is the way. But I think we have always to be a little bit open mind to allow the technology apply with the reliability and safety in mind always, mm-hmm. but to be applied to those boats. So,
excellent. Thank you. I look forward to that future. Now, Mark, as somebody who is building the future, building the boats today, one of the things that has been consistent through the responses on this panel has been that it involves a lot of data, a lot of analysis, a lot of extremely high technology goes into building carbon fiber wings that are 10 centimeters thick, and you know, as long as the stage. Can you talk to us and those watching about some of the challenges it takes of designing, engineering, and indeed fabricating these? And one of the things that I've noticed is that there are lots of boats around the world that are using Persico foils that you haven't built yourself. And so what is that relationship like in supplying such a key component?
Yeah, thanks. I think it goes back to, you know, developing and I guess pioneering at least the manufacturing side, not so much the engineering, but these days they go hand in hand for the last 10 years, really. As Davide said, and also Marcus, I think the foils have evolved so quickly because of the computational power that we have today. You know, if you go back 20 years ago in the America's Cup, I think we used to, scale or understand how much data we're getting off the boat by measuring it in how many megabytes. Yeah. And 20 years later, it's gigabytes. Yeah. You know, so similar to the phone that you had in your pocket, you know, 20 years ago was a phone, and today it's a computer. And so we've just been following that evolution, really. But the manufacturing side has been quite tough, dealing with other yards and other designers and things like that, engineering teams. We've had to follow different engineering solutions for foils for the last 10 years, which they're not all the same. They are different. So the engineers have been learning through that process as much as what we have. Mm. And, you know, 10 years ago, we were building foils pretty similar to what these guys are saying about sailing, and everyone's learning from it. Mm-hmm. We learn just the same, exactly the same. And we were obviously going down areas which sometimes it's a good place to be and sometimes not so good. Mm. We're 10 years down the track. If we execute a foil today, we're very, very comfortable from the time we start till the time we finish to guarantee the quality of the part. You know, there's people say there's no such thing as a perfect composite part today, which we could probably agree to that, but it all comes down to selecting the right materials, working with the right engineers and the people, and having the right systems and processes in place, which we have developed that for 10 years. Now we're doing a lot of things with milling machines, a lot of automation. Now we have an automatic tape laying machine, so something that we used to dream about 20 years ago. Now we actually have a robotic arm that actually laminates a lot of these parts for us automatically. So we're eliminating a lot of the byproducts like plastics, which is good for the environment, but also means we're not applying these into the laminates at the same time. So we guarantee a nice part. So it's been tricky for 10 years to follow everybody, but at the end of the day, that's what we had to do, and that's a learning curve, and that's where we are today.
So there we go, everybody. We've got the rise of the machines. We've got AI computation along with mechanized, automated, to a degree, fabrication. And so it's something that has taken us a long way from sheets of rolls of fiber and pots of epoxy. Just one final word about some of the challenges of building these things. You alluded there to all of the machines and the technology that you're using to fabricate these things. Just pull back the curtain a little bit and give us an idea about what is actually going on in those build sheds.
Good, nice question. I think it's just a matter of Davide, I'm sure, could probably explain it just as much as I can, but at the end of the day, the foils get longer, as long as the stage, and they get thinner and thinner, and these guys here, they drive us crazy, actually, because they just want them to be as thin as possible, but they actually want to pack in as much carbon as you possibly can to make them strong and stiff and light, essentially, and that's the game. So with the computational power and the computer technology that these guys have today, they push the limits of engineering, and that's something that we've did not see, even 5-10 years ago. What we see today is incredible, the level of detail that they can engineer it to. But this also means that for some reason, the builders like us, we have to try and manufacture it to the same level of accuracy, which is really damn hard. So these guys will give us a big piece of paper with all the laminate schedule, which, to be honest with you, is normally in the range of like 200 to 500 layers of carbon. Yeah. Each layer of carbon is around 0.1 to 0.2 millimeters thick, and you have to apply it absolutely perfectly without any porosity, without any air in it. It's a very painstakingly time-consuming process, especially if you do it by hand. So in the early days, we worked out that actually cutting all the material and putting it in the tools, or however you want to make it, was almost, actually was impossible to do it, because every layer that you applied had an offset or a stagger. Every ply got bigger or smaller by less than a millimeter. So if you have 500 plies and you have to cut them perfectly to put into a mold to generate the final shape size, you actually can't do it. So we ended up buying like plotter cutting machines, so digitized cutters that would cut all the plies, until today, where we actually just use a robot that eliminates a lot of that process and can do it for us more accurately, so we can follow the right orientations from the beginning to the end. So these guys will crunch numbers to come up where we need to have 36 degrees on this ply. It must be 36 if you do it by hand. As you can imagine, it's really difficult. So we need to try to go from the design being everything in three-dimensional, all the engineering obviously exactly the same, and plug this into automated processes and technologies. It gives us repeatability and confidence that we've actually built something like these guys design it and engineer it, which is really, really hard. Very, very hard.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Mark, Chris, Simon, Davide, and Marcus. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your expertise. It's nice to get a broad spectrum of perspectives as clearly we go charging ever faster into the future of offshore sailing. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Connor.